control the computer. Vimukthi will explain you the codes that I'm trying to put. And to be very frank, we like to be transparent. We have already coded this. So we'll be copying and pasting, but in a progressive way, so that you all can follow along. Okay? Because if we type, you know, my typing speed is very bad. And we can finish the presentation by around midnight. Okay. So I'm here on my own directory. It's like empty. And I believe you all already went through the documentation.
Do you have any idea on how to create a React app in your application or to install the dependencies?
So this is the React official website. Welcome to the docs. You will have something called getting started. There's two ways you can do it. There's one you can use using X2, and the other way is something that you can use using React Native CLI.
We are actually using React Native, like without using X2, we are going to make this one. Why we are going to do is because in some cases X2 is going to make your life very easy, but with the native code there's more freedom for you all to like install packages which are not supported by X2, or like maybe say in some cases you actually need to write native code. There are no widgets for React Native. So in those cases it's very easy for you to start with the native code rather than doing it first with X2 and then transferring it to the native code. So in here we'll teach you how to.
Okay, how many of you all knows MPM? Everybody, great. So I don't have to go that. I am not going to speak about Node.js, nothing. But we are using Yarn here. So Yarn is also something like React NPM, but you know, you can use it as an alternative. So basically you do a global install of React Native CLI, which I have done already. You need to install Android Studio, which is already done. Or you can simply install the Android SDK, and that's more than enough. But if you are doing it in Mac, it's a different story. But we are doing it on Linux, so we are getting the Android stuff. You need to install the SDKs. You need to set up your environment variables. You're not going to do that, you know, it's time consuming. And that's it. Then you hit this awesome command and your project is done. Okay, so that is what I'm going to do. Okay, so I'm back to my terminal. So I'll say React Native. And we will say this React Native, something like. Yeah, that's more than enough. Okay. And I have okay, I missed the init command. Okay. So this basically, if you all have worked with Angular or React, you would know, you know, the init will basically create you an empty project. So what we are going to do is, we are going to create an empty project and we will try starting and running it. While that happens on the background, I would like to show you this, which is the whole application which is coded. And we have put them in different branches. I will just minimize this. So the master basically has the initialized project. After React init, whatever is on master is everything after React init. Maybe I would have changed the name of the application. Then we have different branches. Each branch has each step done. So you can switch to that branch, which I'm going to do now, and you know, copy paste. You can switch to those branches and see those features. Okay. And happy news is we initialized the project 6 days ago, and we were coding the whole project yesterday and today. Okay. So if we hope that this is completed, I will CD into my project. Now you would see. React Native is up there, which is initialized. I get in there. React Native. Okay. So to install the dependencies, I think it's better to be installed in package.json. Package.json.
I think the count.
Oh. Oh yeah.
Are there people who are not aware of what package.json is or npm is. we'll free to tell us, we'll explain it to you.
Please don't feel bad to interrupt us. You know, we are happy to answer questions, so that way it's more interactive and we can share knowledge. Okay. So, okay. So I'm going to install my dependencies first.
You can simply type yarn. It will do the same thing.
Okay. Dependencies are already there, and I'm going to start my server. That's it. Okay. So that starts up and it has an error. I think I typed something wrong here. Oh, yeah. You could have started. No. Okay, it doesn't like the name which I gave for the project. Okay, so the errors are useful. You can go ahead. So maybe I will rename my project. Let me cd all this, and we are back to step number one. We are native, and we'll say my awesome project. If you are doing it for the first time, you would see it's very slow because you know it's trying to download a lot of stuff, but I have done it multiple times before. It has cached everything, so it's pulling up everything from the cache. So this is faster, but you know the first time it might not be faster as you might expect. Okay, so I'll go into my awesome project and I do yarn install. I think that's already done, and we have yarn start.
In some cases, you actually don't need to start your YAML server. React Native run Android or React Native run iOS will automatically start it for you. But in Linux, sometimes it doesn't work. So that's why we are starting it.
And we'll let the magic happen. You know, it starts at the project, and that's how it goes. So that's step number one. It should complete. I hope it completes fine. Y'all are good till this. I hope it was a very basic thing. Okay. So that's our mobile app. So everything is good in here. So it's normally working as you know you should expect, and we can go, and this is our project. Start, it's all good. So we will move to the next step where we will try to build up a grocery list. Okay. So this is going to be a simple list of items. We are not going to put a very fancy UI, there is no fancy concept. The list will contain some list, it's going to talk to some API. The API basically has a get list, which basically return a list, and every grocery item will have a title and a quantity and an ID, of course. Okay, you can add the item, you can remove an item, you can edit an item, but we are not going to talk much about removing and editing. We will only speak about listing and adding. So that's going to be part of the demo. So we will quickly do some copy paste here and there, and so I'll copy certain components into the project, and Vimukthi will go explaining to you what I really copy and paste. Okay. So my job is easier. Okay. First I'll do here is create new folder for styles. And
we are not going to show you how to style your application today because it will take some time for us to explain it. So we are going to import a file which we have already coded, but it doesn't contain any fancy styles. It's just a basic file.
This is more like CSS. You would see the similarity. but you know, rather than, you know, background dash color, you'll have like background color and all that stuff. But this is very easy to do. It's not very hard.
Why we use yarn is because yarn is faster than MPM, because it caches the packages we have already used. That's why we use yarn more than MPM. Yarn is actually bigger than MPM, but it's way faster and very easy.
What are the other best tools available than VS Code?
Sorry. In here you get plenty of extensions. One could be one that I use is for Flow,
okay,
and for ESLint, and there's another one for React and React Native code completion. We have not installed it in here because
those are VS Code extensions, right?
Yeah, those are VS Code.
Is there any like similar software like this?
Yeah, you can actually use WebStorm for any Sublime or any other mod editor. Why we use VS Code is this is free, and this has lot more support to JavaScript code. Any other questions? That's your fault. Why we are using Android here is because we are using a Linux PC. If you are coding it in a Mac PC, then you can install Xcode. In Apple has made this thing not to expose their SDK to other OS, so you'll have to buy a Mac if you want to develop applications, not to develop it, but to if you want to compile it, and submit it to the App Store. So what you could do is, if you don't have a Mac and if your application is pretty simple, what you can do is do the application with Expo and then let Expo handle the distribution part. So that's an easy way for you to go, but there are some cases where you can't use Expo. One would be like, say, Google Map integration. There are packages which you will need to install to the React Native application that you are building. One easy trick that you can identify if your application requires native code is first, in most of the packages, you will have to link it. If in any case that package requires link, then you can use Expo.
So I have cleaned up the app. You will find something called app.js. I just cleaned up everything and I only left the class there. Okay. So the first ugly thing. So the first ugly thing which I'm going to do is put in a service URL here. Okay. So now what I'm telling is this is my endpoint to the component. Okay. So in a real good application, you should never let the component know about their service endpoints. But you know, the first ugly thing I'll do with this is, you know, have an endpoint within my component right here. Okay. And see what I can do next is I will have a constructor. Okay. It's like any other thing, but this is what the process. You know, every component will have its own storage. So I have a storage and this dot state is more like the storage of that component, okay? And I'm trying to set two variables to be there, and these are very reactive variables, okay? I'm saying loading is true. I could say false, there's no problem, but I'm saying true at the first. And I'm saying the list is empty, which means my grocery list is empty is what I'm saying here. Okay?
And you actually don't require to create a constructor function always. This is useful when, let's say you are creating a class component and you are passing props to that class component and you need it to propagate it to state, then of course you can use constructor. And then as we have done earlier, you can like simply, let's say the loading is, let's say like loading is coming from another component, then we can simply say props dot like loading equal props dot loading. That way you can actually create a stateful component but with props pass.
Okay. So next thing is I am trying to put out a very simple layout here. So what I am saying is render is basically render your layout. So here I am saying, you know, read these two properties, I am just destructuring them here. From the state I am, you know, copying these values and saying, yeah.
Are you aware of what destructuring is? Object to array destructuring is. Can I see some facts? If you are not aware of it, I'll explain. Usual way you would access an object is, let's say the object name is person. If you want to access the name, you would say person.name. But that method is not efficient in ES6. They always advise us to use destructuring, because with destructuring what you are doing is like you are getting those properties which are in object to a separate constant for like in this way. We are like we can actually use this.state dot loading in every case, but in this method like you are not always accessing the object and you are not going through the entire object to access that parameter. So this way it's more efficient and it's the recommended way. That's why we are using destructuring here.
So basically you are reading whatever is in this object into variables here.
Okay.
So what I'm saying is if it is loading, you know, if loading is true, I'm just going to put an empty list out.
Okay.
But you know, if it is not loading, what I would like to do is I have put a container, then I have a list component which I need to create in a minute. I am saying there is a list. And I am saying there is a footer, and this footer simply has, you know, one total item button, which basically will get total from somewhere. So this method I need to code in here. And there is a button to say add. Okay. So shall we quickly code out the component? So I'll do that.
This is one example where we have access object without destructuring. So this is object. So we are accessing the property container in that object without destructuring. You could actually destructure that as well, but we have done it here.
So we have the components. We will try to create one by one components over here.
There are many advantages in separating your board's components. One major advantage we see is reusability and testability. You can actually write component based testing, like unit testing, and then you can if you like bake your entire application into components, then you can actually use it throughout the application, or you can create a shared folder which you can use for other applications as well.
Okay. So as you all remember, we already have the list item or the list component being rendered here, and if we go into this, we have a list as a functional component. So this doesn't hold any state, but what this does is it uses a flat list. So we have wrapped the flat list within a list of our own, and for each list item we are trying to render a list item. So a list item will take in parameters of a title and a quantity.
BJ has done a small mistake, which is not a functional mistake, it's just a naming convention that we use. We always try to name the component, like functional component, in simple, so that it's more identified. He has used capital S, but it should be simple.
It's simple here, and it should be simple here is as well, he's saying. The convention is that I should have used simple L here also. Okay. So the next component would be our list item.
Not a must follow, but it will be easier for you to identify the functional components over stateful components.
The list item is doing a lot of steps. So we will go through it slowly. You know, it has its own state, which basically has a title, quantity, and it says on edit, because this is while editing, we will keep a flag whether it's on edit mode or whether it's on view mode. So what we are doing here is, you know, we basically, if it is on edit mode, we have a text input. We have two input buttons, which will have the same values, simple as that. But if it was on view mode, we simply have a label kind of a thing, which basically is known as text component in React Native, and we display the items. Okay. So this basically shows if it is on edit mode, an input field, or two input fields basically, or two labels, if it is on view mode. So that's about the list item. Then coming back to our app.js, let me say this. We also have one more item or component which is known as the total, which displays the total. Okay. So let me create that. So the total item basically takes in a total value, and it shows, you know, with a print of total items, and it displays the total. Simple as that. So wrapping back again, you know, we have a render function which will render a list of items, and below that it will show a total of that item, and below that it has an add bar.
So we can go to the list component. In here we have used blacklist. You can actually create a custom component where you can list it, but why we use blacklist? It's optimized for mainly it's for iOS. In iOS there's this feature where like the components which are not visible in the viewport get destroyed. So the application is more optimized. So if you have like a list of 1,000 records, even if you scroll down the mobile application, it will be not smooth. So always try to use the components which are provided by React Native and try to build upon that rather than using a third party library.
Okay. So there are a few functions that we need to complete here. For example, you know, this says, you know, on submit items are like on list item submit, and then says at list item, and we don't see any way to fetch all the list from the API. So we will start adding code related to this. So whenever the component starts mounting, I would like to fetch all the items. So I'll say React has a function called component dismount, similar to
update component with unmount just plain. Why we access component like API in component dismount is because we always need to change the state in component dismount, not in any other lifecycle events. Because if you change, if you are trying to change the state of that component in any other lifecycle events, it will one thing, it will definitely update the state, but it will create performance issues, and the state will be unpredictable. So always try to access the API for change the state within component dismount.
Okay. So we have this fetch list item method, and now I put down the listing. We are using the fetch library itself, which is inbuilt. We are not trying to go fancy. So what we are saying is we are setting loading to true again, you know, which is already the case. I say fetch, and this service URL is the service URL which is on top. We are going to make a get request because fetch by default is get. And we say take the results and pass the JSON. And then we say, okay, now set the list to the list and make loading false. Simple as that.
Another one you could improvement you could do here is there's a new feature in ES6 where you can assign object, like if you have the variable already in the object name, then you can, without like saying the lid should be equal to the response, then you can remove this entire part and then leave it at the mark. Then it will automatically assign it to that object name. Object, sorry, part.
Fine. So fetch items is done, and we have some missing pieces here because we have a method here to call, you know, to sum up the total. So I will get that. That what we are doing is we are simply looping through the list and trying to make a total of it. Okay.
Fetch dot JSON is a built-in method.
Sorry.
Fetch dot JSON is a built-in method.
Yeah, it is. It comes with
fetch API.
Yeah. Not fetch API.
It's a different.
It basically takes the JSON body out of the body rather than leaving all the headers and out and simply leaves the body. Okay. So with getTotal we are not doing anything much. It's an arrow function out of ES6. We go through the list of, we loop through the list and we have a sum variable and we are taking the quantity and we are looping and adding one after the other.
And you use map, reduce, those ES6 array manipulation functions before. What reduce does is, this is mainly used for calculating, this is one good example, like if you want to list down all the things in let's say array, you are going to use the map function, but in here we are actually like let's say we need to calculate the total or the quantity, we need to append all the strings, like all the array items to one string. Then we can actually use this one, which is very easy. And there are plenty of other array manipulation functions which you can go home and research about it. And this is one we have used to calculate the total. We actually can use map function as well, but we'll have to then maintain and not like declare variable for sum on the top and let's sum equals 0 and then like add it. But this method, it's very easy to calculate the sum.
So the next one I'm going to say is, you know, this add item. So add item will never submit an API call. Add item basically does this, you know, there is an already a list. This will temporarily put an item into that list, you know, just as a placeholder item. Okay. So if, when I paste this function, you will understand, you know, what I've done there. So this basically gets the state, you know, gets the list from the state and basically adds one more object into that.
Yeah. Why we use this method is because you can actually create a separate model to add items to the list. But in here we thought of not going to make another screens and then passing it to this one. One thing is it will be difficult for you to understand at first. With this method, you don't need to go to another page and then come back. You can simply add it in this item, and in then and there you can type the name and the quantity and then save it.
Yeah. And we set the editable mode to true, so it will be two input boxes. Plus, we are putting a fake ID in there. So let me paste that fake ID on top because we are defined to be not consistent. Yeah.
One good practice you could do is like always defining your condition that you are going to use in function, because this way you are not going to make spelling mistakes. Let's say in another place if you are going to see if these two match, then you can simply use this function without like typing it.
So next one is like after putting all his input values, he's going to pick save, you know. So once save, we need to fire a function up. So that is this fetch call, which is going to make a post request to the API. So this is a bit bigger. We'll go through it. Okay, so it makes a fetch request on the same URL, but this time it's a post request with the necessary headers. And on the response, what it takes is now we have designed the API in such a way, once you save, it will return the same object back, the saved object. So we take this object, we map through this list this time because we want to keep the list as that. And we try to match this new ID which we put a fake placeholder, and we remove that item and we are updating our this one, and we also say that the editable mode is false, it's no more editable, it's like already saved. So that is what we are doing. We are not handling all the errors here. We are just console logging all the errors for the moment, because we will speak about error handlers later.
In here we have used save method. You never in here, as you have seen already, state is defined top, and the normal practice would be to say this dot stay equal in the new thing. But it's not recommended in React. You always have to manipulate the state immutably, not mutably. This way, we actually the early approach was to it was a long one. We had to go through everything and then this dot state, then spread it and but this method is very easy. You can't manipulate anything that you are not modifying. So we are simply updating the disk in the state. Nothing more than that. Not even loading or anything. So this is a PM method that you could use, provided by React.
So I think we have everything that is needed for our first application. This was the hardest part. All the others are, migrating things from here and there. So we have a very good constructor. We are fetching the needed items. We calculate the total. When somebody press on adds, we put a take thing in there, then on submit we handle everything. So I believe we can run it. Sometimes we might run into errors, but we'll hope the best, nothing wrong happens and everything is all good. So I come back to my terminal. Yeah, start is already, it's happy and there's nothing wrong and our this thing is running. So we will come and you can click on double R just to refresh this, and if there is an error, everything will come up to you. Okay, so instances like this happen. So what we have is, we have a tool called React Native Debugger, which will help us in debugging, which we also wanted to introduce to yourself.
Especially when you are using Redux, and this tool is going to help you a lot, because in there you can see what actions are fired and how the state is manipulated. So this is going to come handy to you.
This is just similar to your DevTools? Nothing went wrong. Actually, the API call was very slow. Okay, so everything went good. What you can do is you can, try to enable network inspect. You can go back here and just see all these things. Just a little bit. I'll just refresh again. We already have two bad items which is added already in there. Okay, just ignore them. So you can see here there would have been a request which went through. So maybe I am not yet connected to it. Let me, and I will say debug is remotely, so it connects to this. And now you see that the API call went through and we got a list back. So there are two items and these two items are displayed back on this.
We have created a small API with MongoDB, which we will expose it to you so that you can find this.
Okay. So it has two and I think there is something wrong with the addition here. I have appended it.
This was done very recently, because this will actually, you will come across this one. You cannot pass numbers to text input, which is the native input element available in React. They are not supporting numbers, so you always have to pass integers, strings.
Okay.
That's why in here the addition didn't work, because those are two string objects, string items. So it will happen together.
I was going in the wrong place. Okay.
Yeah.
So we'll do a passing, because always our quantity is just whole numbers. Okay. Now we have a very good program. So that's all good. So we'll try adding one. So when I click on add, you can see this next item is a fake item which is only available locally, and it puts to input. I can say a new item, and I'll put in a quantity of 10, and then I can save this. Okay, so when saving this, you can all it's saved, and I'll go back to my debugger tool, and you can see there was a post request up here which went through. Okay, so everything good and everything saves, and all the total calculates back to Vina. So this is the application that we have, but this is very ugly. Because you know, there's a lot of problems, we'll try to explain one by one. So as we said earlier, there's many problems up in here. One thing is, you know, service call happens within the component, which is very, very bad. A component should never know about its service layers. It should not know how the API exists. We should try to separate them as much as possible. Then these components know about those properties. You know, it knows about list, it knows about loading. Component should be always a view layer, because in real good programming or enterprise application, sometimes you can think about changing your view component. You can totally change it. So when you change your view component, you have all your data bind in there. So it's very very hard, and for you to migrate or you know to change the UI component, the look and feel of it, it's very hard to look at. But if you have only the UI there, it's much more easier to do for you to do, and also it's very highly testable. You know, you can even test your UI. Just as something called snapshots, you can use them to test your front ends.
Can you use design patterns?
Design patterns? Like yeah, we'll explain as you go on.
Okay. Yeah, we haven't used any advanced stuff.
It's available with the React Native.
Yes.
Okay. And the fetch, as I said, you know, you should know about the service layer, and you know, these kind of things can be done more efficiently rather than being done here, because every time a new item is added, there is a total going on, you know, it needs to calculate, it needs to loop. This thing is not very efficient to do in here, and it should not be related to this. That is a good thing. And apart from that, you know, all looks good.
And if you could go up, all the success of the... So here we have done a small gimmick. We are not going to, like, with the API response, sometimes you might not get the entire list, like, resource, like, in here we are only getting the added new item. So what we have done is we have removed the new item that we have added, and then simply pass the API response. So we are not going to send another API request to the get request and then populate the list.
Okay, so the first problem we are going to solve from here is we will try to remove all the service calls and try to remove all the property dependency from the component. We are not going to make a better service yet. We will worry about that later. But right now, we want to take these elements out of from the component. Okay, so that is what we are trying to do first. So at the end of the second section, we are going to introduce Redux and Redux Tunk. And when I try to do basic coding in here, he will give you an explanation of what Redux will help you with and Redux Tunk will help you with. Those are two different major players in the JS world. And so the idea is to introduce Redux first and then eventually Redux Tunk. So to do that, you know, how we migrate from here to there is one big question. So first thing we need to understand here is what are the actions that we do in here. What things we are trying to do in here, especially related to service, could be synchronous or asynchronous service. First thing is I am trying to fetch the list. That's one action I am doing. And second action that happens is the fetch can be success, the fetch can be failure. So that's three actions already. Similar way, the other asynchronous request we have is saving. So I am trying to request to save. And this request can be successful, the request can be a failure, there can be validation issues. Okay, so there is already six actions we identified, and there is one more action. Is somebody in the crowd identified it? No. Okay, with this method we are trying to add a dummy item. So for example, when we try to add an item, we into the list put a dummy item, a placeholder item which is only available locally, but on say we send this item back up and then we refresh our list again on the store. Okay, so that is what is happening. So that is an item which is not asynchronous. It's a synchronous action that we are doing. We are trying to put a dummy item inside the state. So anything related to the state, we don't want to manipulate inside a component. Component should only have states related to it. You know, if it is doing something only within its own self and it should not be known to the outside world, then the component should have that state. Apart from that, you should kind of maintain a whole DB of your whole application somewhere else. That is what Redux is going to do for us. It's going to maintain kind of storage or a DB, a global one, for us, And what's related to a component, we can put it inside a component, but mostly, very rarely you will have those steps. For example, if you are trying to type an input and you want to keep those values and do something related to it, you can have a local component, you don't want to put it to the store.
And okay. You can actually skip Redux and simply maintain the entire state in one component, but it's going to, Redux is in the industry is because that way you will have to pass all the props like down the line. Let's say there's a component on top, like in here we have a list list component, and there are like list items and then list item, so that's like three component. But in a real world application, there could be if you drill down to the end, there could be 20 to 30 components, and passing all those props in between is going to be heretic. So Redux is going to help us that way, and it's going to give you a small function which is called connect, which is going to simply connect the one central store to that component. Hello.
Okay, and we don't want to have a lot of steps here. I'll just delete this, which I created. We will try to create a folder called app, and then we'll try to put everything related inside that. So we will have a folder, and we'll say app. That's good. And within this, we'll try to create all the other steps. So we'll call something called action types. So as we identify, we already have 7 action types. We will try to put all those action types in here.
I will give you a basic introduction on what Redux is and how Redux works. In there, the Redux is a store state managing library that you get for JavaScript, any JavaScript project. It could be Angular, it could be React Native, or it could be Vue.js. You can use it for any JavaScript project. In there, you can simply maintain the state, and those state is going to be manipulated by actions. These are the actions we are going to use, and to trigger those actions, we are going to need action dispatches. So that we are going to create in the folder called actions.
Yeah. So as we identified already, these are the 6-7 set of actions that we already have. One is, you know, fetch list request, fetch list failure and success. Similar way for sale. And the other one which we discussed, you know, is a temporary synchronous action. Then we have the
in here we have only one action types, but in a real world application there's going to be 20 to 30 action types. It depends on how you structure your application. That's why we are using identify in here, so that's easy for us to see where from where that's dispatched. So this is actually very good practice to use, so that you know from which action type it's dispatched.
So that's a lot of chunk of code, but we'll go one by one. Okay. So now we have the request or the method. So the request outside of the component which we are going to use. We are going to refactor those components later, but we will put these pieces here. So on fetch request, we simply fetch request async. That is the method which is going to fetch the list for us. Okay. So this is a bit of thunk in play. Thunk will basically dispatch actions for us. It will wrap them. So this piece here is Redux thunk. So when you call this method, it will automatically inject this dispatch method for us inside of.
That's what I call action dispatcher. This is going to dispatch an action. Thunk is you can actually use Redux without thunk, but thunk is going to help you in dispatching actions. A better way to do handle asynchronous actions would be using Redux Saga, but we are not going to reduce you to another third party library, and we are not going to complicate it. You can simply handle asynchronous request in Redux thunk as well, but for that we'll have to create three or more actions depending on what your requirement is. But like in here we have created three. One is to initialize, one is to get the initialization action, then for the failure and the success part. But with Redux Saga, you can simply do it in one function.
Okay.
Let's start with...
If you forget these two lines, it's the same thing which I was doing in the app component JS already. Okay. I'm doing a fetch to some URL, and I take the response, and this is another line which I have added. Rather than doing everything there, I dispatch an action for somebody else to take care of it.
This could be a advanced thing for you to understand at first. So I'll start with the grocery list writer. This is a very simple action dispatching, but it does this what we do is we create the type of the action. So in here we say it's at grocery list writer. Why we created action type file is because then we are going to store all the action names in there and we are going to export it so that we can reuse it in the reducer and in here. And you can actually type it. Let's say you can in here you can type at grocery list item. But then in the reducer also you'll have to type it. And as everyone does, we are going to make mistakes when typing English words or code. So that's going. Sometimes you might not be able to identify the mistake you did, and you will have to spend more time on
debugging
rather than actually coding. That's why we always try to keep it in
context.
So
again, coming back, so that's a very simple action. So here we are doing. We will go to this dispatcher, what that dispatch does later, but here the same thing happens. You know, I'll pull up the approaches again. We can refactor this again. You can see, you know, there's a fetch which does something to a URL. Then there is this response and you set this state. But this we are going to do somewhere else. So the similar thing you will see, you know, we do a fetch, but now we have this cool dispatch thing. So we do a dispatch on request. We do something before the request. On the response, we dispatch a success. On failure, we dispatch a failure. We'll do something with that later. Similar for the same.
In a simple one, in here, we don't have to get the dispatch and then do it manually. It will simply dispatch the action. But in this case, we are actually taking the dispatch out because we need to dispatch three actions in here. So it could be more. That's why we have taken dispatch out and then manually dispatching three actions. Depending on the asynchronous state.
What he was explaining is, for example, in this case, you only dispatch one action. So you can basically directly do that. You don't have to do that dispatch thing. It will work as it is. For save also, we have three dispatches. Save is also something similar. We have a fetch, a post, we have a response. We do something with the response, but we don't care about it here. Okay.
So a simple way to put dispatcher is, a dispatcher is an action where you're going to manipulate the state. Every action which you are going to manipulate the state is going to be action dispatcher. So in here, in the fetch list request, we are going to set the loading to true. That's why we have one. And then in the fetch list failure, we are going to set the errors to the state. That's why we have another. In the success, what we are going to do is we are going to get the API response and put it to the store. That's why we have three. So if you do not have such actions, then you can simply forget about the request and failure and simply use success for whatever you require.
Okay. So about Redux, there is only two main things. There is actions and there is reducers. So the reducers is the next part where after dispatching things will be handled. Okay. So
this is where the state is going to be saved. Like in the we have done in component, we are going to in here we are maintaining the. Can you go back to the actions? So in here we have two states, that's loading and list. What we are going to do is we are going to get it out and take it to the Redux. In this actually it's not required for you to take it to the Redux store. We can actually maintain this loading of course we can loading and list of course we can maintain it here as well, but it is a good this is kind of the simplest application where we could explain what Redux store is. That's why we are
putting everything back on the store. Yeah. So on the reducer, what we have is we have this initial state set up here. So it's like a global storage where we are stating the same thing here. We are initializing list and we are putting loading to false. And we wrote this thing here also. And within this is where we, change our state, we maintain our state, depending on particular actions, we do steps. For example, if it is a fetch list request, we execute this function. So when there is a fetch coming, we basically, do the state, keep the same state and change loading into true. The loading was initially false, we change it to.
This is what I call updating a state immutably. Like in the component, we didn't like do. Do you know what spread operator does? Who in here doesn't know? Feel free to see. Okay. What spread operator do is like we can use spread operator in arrays and objects. So what it does is, let's say we have two objects. One could be person number one. The other one could be person number two. And let's say they have a that will be a bad example for me. Let's say there are two objects which another the first object extend the second one. Then what we could do is we could spread all the properties of the first object to the second. It's simple as that. So even it's same with array. Let's say there's an array with colors, and there's another one with the same colors, but we need to add another one called black. So what we are going to do is, what we are going to spread the first array, and then we are going to add the new item that we want. We have done the exact same thing. We have got the first state and we have spread it, so that we have all those properties, and we are going to manipulate the loading state, just the loading state, to true.
So that is on a fetch list request. So for example, if fetch list success happens, we do this, you know, we get the list of data. So we come back here, we take the same state, we are updating the new list into the list, you know, we have a new list from there, so we update that new list. We make loading into forks. That is what fetch does. And add a grocery list item, this is the fake heading, you know, the placeholder heading. What we do is we spread the same state, we spread the same list, and we add an extra one. This is the array example which he was talking about. You spread everything, you copy everything inside the list into the new array, plus you put a new element or new object into that array with the properties that you want.
This is a must-do in React. You always have to update the state immutably. So let's say there's another one called in here, maybe something like prices, and then you will have to get the spread it from the topmost one, and then manipulate it. So that's a practice you actually have to do everywhere in React.
Okay, so this is the biggest item that we have in here. So if you see, it's the same thing that we did here. So, you know, we took the list, we spread the list, and we added our new item in here. Except that this is in one line and this we have in multiple lines. Okay. So it does the same thing. Save item, you know, it gets the saved item here. So it does the same thing. It sets the loading to false. It maps through it and removes the item which matches the ID new item. And it makes true to false.
Yeah. What we have done here is we are going to look through the entire list and search for the newly added one. So that's where this one comes. We have checked if those two items are equal. And we are not going to in map you always has to return the item so that this one gets the properties of that list. So, but in here, we have checked if that item is the new one we have created. If that's the case, then we are going to